different. Welcome in my new video. This video you might not want to see out of fear for your sense of safety in relationship to your worldview. Your worldview might be a little bit disturbed after you see what I'm going to tell you about in this video. And everything that I'm going to tell you about in this video is true and should put you and your thoughts, in case you do not yet agree with me, on another pathway of development and learning, and hopefully also make you join the Patreon, the Dowland Healthcare, so that we can together work on the realization of the actual goals of Chinese medicine and Kung Fu. And I look forward to tell you this story for the simple reason that it is always nice to talk about yourself, because this is basically my story, and my story in that sense should be your story also. And from this, I hope you take some leads and join me in my quest for the search of what Chinese medicine, Neidan, Tai Chi, Kung Fu, Wudang culture, and so on and so forth is really about. And for this, we have to ask ourselves a few questions. First thing I want to start with is that our worldview is an important part of who we are. Our worldview determines what we can see, what we can ask, and what we believe, of course, about the reality that is around us. The reality of around us seems very normal to us, but it is rooted in particular kind of assumptions. Neurologists might say, well, you know, your perception of reality is related to your neurons and on your body chemistry and so on and so on, and that is why it is possible that in different cultures we have different worldviews, because these different worldviews are trained by different circumstances. So the circumstances, like what we see in DNA and RNA sampling, are determining eventually what the culture is like, and therefore also what is recognized as true and what is recognized as not true. Our worldview is what gives us a sense of normalcy, and that normalcy creates at its own turn a sense of safety, because what is normal is safe to us. Everything that is not normal, that is not safe to us. That's part of our herd mentality. You see with herd animals, everything is fine, but as soon as it moves, it is suspect. And it is a little bit similar for us. If our reality, our sense of reality changes, then of course, then everything becomes suspect and we become anxious on the inside. In the story of the Buddha, you see that the transformation process from being a prince to becoming the Buddha is a very slow and gradual process that step by step brings the Buddha to another worldview. And you see in the Taoism and the trainings of Taoism, it's similar. Our bodily changes, our mental changes, our worldview, everything is changed step by step to make sure that we are not becoming anxious as a result of our training, but that we become acquainted with different worldviews, and as a result of that can come to a fruitful effect of what we are studying. You have to understand that the safety of the parameters of what we accept as being real also describes already beforehand when we become diseased and when we become psychologically confused, when we become unsuitable to work at our jobs or to function in our marriages or in our relationships in general, or how we become unsuitable as parents. In things like disease, authority, relationships and so on and so on, these are all based on sets of rules which define what is good and what is not good, what is working and what is not working. If everything works, we experience a sense of freedom. It doesn't matter if we live in a military totalitarian state or in a capitalist totalitarian state. In both cases, we can feel free no matter what is the circumstance of politics. But freedom is a carrot which is kept in front of us all the time, while in fact freedom is, of course, the freedom of anxiety. So some people who radicalize, they experience their reality as normal, and they think it's very normal to put on a vest with bombs and then start killing people. This is the result of this same process that I'm just describing. This movie of today is partly inspired by the speech that the Chinese President Xi Jinping gave to the Chinese people as a result of what happened in the last year, 2020, and what he hopes is going to happen in the coming, well, time. We know that he wants to become president for a long time and he's not planning to go, but he talks all the time about his dreams for the future where all the Chinese people are going to see improvement. And as a result of the improved comforts that people have in life, they already experience a lot of freedom. That stands in strong contrast with what we experience in the West, where gradually the constraints of our lives are becoming bigger and bigger, and as a result of that, people they start protesting their life and start rebelling against government. The West and its capitalist notions, of course, is built on a sort of a pyramid scheme where some people stand on the top and they are the rich ones, or the powerful ones, and the rich and the powerful ones are partly overlapping, and then you have all the other people, which is, you know, usually called the middle class and the ones that drop out. What we see that happened in China is that the Chinese government has in the last 30-40 years militarized its population to create the social cohesion necessary to create that economic prosperity that they are looking for, similar to our Western prosperity. They're still behind on us in many respects, for a large part of the population anyway, but in general they're doing pretty good, and in all kind of fields they are catching up, as they should and as every nation in the world should, because we should all be more or less on the same prosperity level everywhere in the world. There should not be any country richer than any other country. There should not be any country more powerful than any other country. Everything should be in a perfect harmony to make sure that we all have good lives. The Chinese have based their model on the Japanese model, who first started militarizing its population to create an economic boom after the Second World War. And that worked for the Japanese, and the Chinese, of course, were hoping to make it work for themselves, and now they export that model all over the world, including their authoritarianism and state control. Anyway, how I get there is that, as you might know, or maybe not, I was born with kidney infections, and as a result of these kidney infections, well, I had quite a restless, ill-natured youth, and I was operated at a certain point at my ninth year, because everybody assumed when I was born that it would pass when I would grow older, but it didn't pass. And in fact, I was operated just in time before I would have been connected to an artificial kidney and not have been able to do any of the things that I'm doing right now. I had a four hours long operation, and the operation only treated half of my kidneys and my bladder and my bladder channel and so on, which were all infected, and everything was on the verge of failing. I will spare you all the details, but the thing is that they had me so long under sedation that they decided after 4 hours, and I already wake up in the operation a few times also, by the way, that they should not operate longer, and they only were halfway at that moment, and they expected my body to cure itself. They also predicted that I would not get older than 40 years old, or maybe a little bit older, but not much older than that, and as a result of that, I would die most likely for kidney failure. And the other thing is that they said you could never do any exercise, because when you do exercise you actually have a run, you run a risk that you damage your kidneys, which is of course something that happens with people when they exercise, because they overdo, they poison their body, and the kidneys have to do very hard work. I ventured into yoga and qigong because that was not considered exercise and sports, and as a result of that I learned to manage and balance all the different functions of my body over time, all the different phases of how I got there I will spare you also. And at a certain point I came to the current experience I'm in with the Daoland program, which is based on my collected and knowledge and understandings of how that works within the Taoist model. I tried out all kind of models. You can just imagine anything. Also, as part of my studies, I became a member of any sect that I could imagine, where I thought there might be some secrets there, but You know, most of the time it was just power games. I'm old enough not to remember which year I published my first book, and this was about Qigong, and in the Dutch language, it was the first book ever published about this topic. There was it was still a relatively new subject, and I will not tell you now how I got to that point. But the book became relatively popular. Everybody saw it as something very important, a momentous event, so to say, and it basically expressed a worldview that is still very much alive in the Qigong world, that you see, for instance, in the Shift Network, and you see it in in the Taoist Association of different countries. You see it in the Chinese medicine culture. You see it in all kinds of other things. There are particular kind of ideas present in these kind of studies, which I was part of, which are in essence just made up. Better not bore you also with all the other things that I did before I got to this point. But at a certain point, I was invited by the IOC Foundation to write a bachelor master thesis about Chinese medicine history, and especially in Qigong, because energy medicine, of course, was a very hot topic, and the production of my book actually instigated more of that, or it was the other way around. That's already too long ago. Anyway, my mentor, Professor Hakemilder, and other people associated with the IOC Foundation, such as Professor John Tootman and some other people, they stimulated me to do my research. And in the first instance, I basically confirmed everything I did in my first book. And as a result of that, I decided at a certain point that I needed to know more. When I started my career, I started as a masseur, healer, all these kind of things that everybody nowadays seems to do when they have nothing else to do. When I came to a particular kind of point asking questions about discrepancies in books on Chinese medicine and so on, I decided to go follow a course on the history of Western esoterics as a starting point to study more deeply into the study of Chinese esoterics as part of Chinese medicine and so on. I did so at the University of Amsterdam under the guidance and mentorship of Professor Wouter Hanegraaff, and he had some amazing and definitely inspiring ideas, and in general the whole program was an eye-opener. I got into this program because of a friend of mine called Patrick, big guy, and he knew basically everybody in the alternative and the esoteric scenes in the Netherlands, and we had very many long and interesting conversations, and everybody I met through him was worth the trouble. I'm not myself a networker by nature, so I'm not very good in maintaining my contact. So if I have a contact that is valuable, I really treasure it here, but I do not necessarily do all the work to maintain that contact. Now, I'm very happy with the Patreon environment, where people can actually sign up and they can do that work themselves. And as a result of that, I can focus on the things that I do best, namely research and telling about what I learned. The first semester of the minor I was studying at basically was a little bit of a shock to me, and there were a few points that I think I should point out to make you clear why it was a little bit of a shock to me, because it really turned my worldview upside down and it gave a whole new direction to my research, and it also made it I started working on a completely different set of assumptions, which is of course the foundation of the current Taoland program. First of all, I realized that the history, what we call usually the history of Western esoterics and the way how it is being expressed in all kind of books, very often is very unfounded and is mostly just theater to sell more books or to sell more participation in courses. I remember my publisher said to me, like, you shouldn't care about the fact that you get underpaid by writing a book, because the book is going to produce an audience which will eventually pay your life, which it did, of course. But mostly now I deny the value of my own book because of the reasons that I started learning in this Western esoteric history course. And there are at clearly experimenters in this, like the Golden Dawn and stuff like this, who try to popularize their visions, the Jungian psychologists, which are just basically the same, and also all these new Druid and neo-paganist movements, which are all based on the same assumptions that are all going back to, in essence, Anton Mesmer. I will not tell you now about Anton Mesmer. For this you have to look below for some references to see in the Patreon post, of course, for to see what it is all about. The thing is, mesmerist research created a whole new set of activities, originating in the exorcisms of the Catholic Church and developing the idea of animal magnetism from the divine fluids. And as a result of that, all the magnetizing schools that were being popular in the end of the 19th century, middle of the 19th century. And you can find books in secondhand bookstores everywhere. The same information transferred itself to the United States. Mediumship came there, hypnotism, modern psychology was developed out of that. But it was also transported to China through Hong Kong and other places in China. These kind of ideas came into China and became popularized and revolutionized the anti-historical movements of China from the Qing dynasty towards Maoism and even the current Chinese PRC policies towards Chinese culture. They emphasized that part. And as a result of that, the popularization of all these Western ideas in China, they indigenized it sort of. And as a result of that, when Westerners went to China, they saw all these amazing things happening in China, which was all very public and also pretty much market-based, a form of neo-capitalism in the communist era. And people thought it was authentic Chinese because everybody said, like, this is from our thousands of years old history. Well, you know, I can tell you that they think that yumi, mice, corn, that is a Chinese vegetable, while it was introduced by the West in China somewhere 2 centuries ago or something like this. But now they claim it is already thousands of years in China. It's not, but the farmers really think that. People in China generally, they think that all these things like Falun Gong and so on, that it is Chinese, while it is in fact based on Western esoterics. So all these people who went to study Qigong with Mantak Chia, Stephen Chang and all the other people, they were doing something that was either created by the PRC as part of their TU program, their nationalist sports program, or on the basis of Western esoterics. So, you know, it looked Chinese, but it wasn't. Western esoterics is based on a scientific fallacy in the sense that it tried to transport something from Catholic religion into Western science, and that is a form of scientism in itself. Catholicism, in my view anyway, is in itself a science, and it's a science that belongs to a particular kind of worldview. Science has a worldview, and it creates the instruments to confirm itself. And what people were doing in the secularization of spirituality is moving the ideas from Catholicism, which went into that direction, into the scientific direction there, without having actually the scientific proof for what they were saying. And as a result of that, they came up with all kind of assumptions and also a sense of superiority over what science actually was doing. Science was materialist, while what they were doing was spiritual, and therefore it was basically superior. You know, the message of ISIS and Al-Qaeda is very similar like that. They are all Western movements, and they are not necessarily Arab movements in the essence of their thinking. They are the result of the colonization process that the West made the world go through, and that brought us everywhere good things, but it also brought us bad things. Oh, look at that, one of my princesses. One of the other things that was very important, and the other princess, one of the important things of what I learned at the course of Western esoterics is that Immanuel Kant had such a great influence on Western culture. Immanuel Kant wrote the Kritiek der reinen Vernunft as a way to piss on Immanuel Swedenborg, of which he was just a bit jealous. And as a result of that, he created a new view on reality, which turned our Western culture in a direction through which we have a hard time studying the past and actually understanding it according to the principles that in the past were intended. We have to view things through our modern language, and that is of course a natural thing. If a culture changes, it changes its future. It's called cultural drift, and cultural drift can be a good thing, but it can also be a bad thing. So I'm not making a moral judgment about these things that they happened, but just on the fact that, you know, a fourth, but not so little significance, is that Western culture went through what we call a process of secularization, where we created a separation between the private and the state, and a separation between the private and the state on the one hand, and religion on the other hand, and also, of course, that religion became a private process, an internal process of you, instead of, matter of the king or the president or whatever rules the country. In China, we are assuming very often that China is a secular nation because of the nature of Confucianism, which says it is not religious, while in fact it is very religious because it worships power. It is part of the animist tendencies of Chinese culture, and as a result of that you can see that Chinese culture never went through a secularization process. It just seems to use the language of secularization, while in fact Buddhism, Taoism, Confucianism, these are really the three religions of China, united in animist worldview. On top of that, you can say that Chinese culture has mostly westernized. It has maintained its ideas about morality, which is part of Confucian religion. Morality and power, they come together. While maintaining that sense of moral values in reality, that is their religious foundation, they have changed, of course, a lot in that they took Western science, Western industry, Western building techniques, Western technology, everything into their own hands, and they also absorbed a lot of Western ideas, and they reasserted a lot of values in their culture through these Western eyes, and as a result of that they actually changed their culture. So similar like the Kantian revolution in the West, the Chinese went through this Westernization process, which also created a barrier to understand whatever happened in the past. What I want to point out here primarily is that what I learned from Hanegraaff and the history of Western esoterics is that cultures both in the East and the West, they went through all kinds of transitions, and it is not just a matter of China and the West, but all cultures in the world basically have, through the colonization process and the Westernization process, gone through that process. Most cultures, in the way how they appear different to us, they are in fact manifestations of the same reality, namely the Western worldview. So you might think that you do something Asian, or you might think that you do something African, or you might do something Australian, but to a large degree you are doing Westernized things. I want to say is, when I was busy writing my master thesis and started preparing for my PhD, I basically was almost finished and I decided to go everything into another direction, which is the reason why the Taoland program is nowadays here and offered to you as a possible participant to learn into. Because there were some realizations which I think were important for myself, which I think should be important to you too, in case you want to study Chinese medicine or Taoist medicine or Tai Chi Chuan or Qigong or anything like that, if you wanted to be really Chinese at least. First of all, of course, there is this case that all these things Chinese that we are studying are actually rooted in mesmerism, which is French. This means that the process of learning from Chinese things is basically learning Western things with a Chinese dress-up. So what I concluded for my research is that if I want to study Chinese medicine, if I want to study Taoism and so on and so on, I had to go to pre-modern culture, and I had to let go of whatever happening in this modern time, which is not an easy task if the language is actually denying you access to the past. So this is what we have been working on in the Taoland project so far. When I went to China, I did do the anthropological thing by immersing myself into the local culture, but I also had to de-sinify, to modernize what I learned in China. And the funny thing is that if I would talk to old Taoists, they would usually understand what I said, but if I talk to young Taoists, they would usually be locked into this Maoist reality that is still holding the way of thinking in its grip that is all over China. Man, you have no idea. The history of any country is so... Anyway, as a part of the outcomes of my study, I have to summarize a few ideas. I take my notebook with it because it's easier. It's also getting more busy here, so I try to hurry a bit to not embarrass myself too much. First of all, the goals of Chinese medicine, you know, they are not similar to those of Western medicine. And second, the methods of Chinese medicine are not similar to those of Western medicine. And the theories of Chinese medicine are not similar to those of Western medicine. And fourth, the methods of learning of Chinese medicine are not similar to the methods of learning in Western medicine. And these are important things to discuss with you. The first point that I made, the goals of Chinese and Western medicine, you can see that the goals of Western medicine is to keep you at work in the workflow of the militarized capitalist and consumerist societies, which means that you are a human resource and you are not a person, and when medicine is applied to you, it has to do with how you can go back into the workflow. You don't have to be repaired or healed or anything like that, but you mostly want to be able to provide, to be a resource. In Chinese medicine, on the other hand, we see that the purpose of or the goals of the Chinese medicine is to humanize you, to become more human and to actually mature in the process of being human, and as a result of that, your healing process is to actually realize your full potential as a human, not so much your full potential on the work floor or in your family life. As a result of these goals, in Western worldview, you are basically laid off at the moment when you cannot be a resource anymore. You're going to be put into a die-off place, and they stop your medication when you stop paying for being alive. Because if you can't contribute to the production process and you can't afford being alive, then what is your functionality in this society? While in Chinese culture, actually in the aging process, traditionally anyway, you were supposed to become more valuable to society because you give an historical view of events of the past, and your accumulated wisdom is part of what makes your experience within your profession, such as Chinese medicine, valuable. When we look at the methods of Western medicine, you see that there are of course many methods which are usually very mechanic or chemical, and they induce all kinds of processes with prodding and pulling and putting knives in you or medications in you, chemicals, to get you back to work. And these methods, they cut you up in small segments and they treat a particular small segment in the hope that a larger segment actually falls in place, which is a little bit like playing pool. And at the moment, when you look at the Chinese model, you see that the methods such as acupuncture and qigong and massage and herbalism and exorcism and fu writing, and they're all part of the Chinese medicine repertoire. They all have to do with your humanization process. These methods, they're all primarily educational methods to help you get along in becoming healthy and making sure that you stay like that. The theories of Western medicine in modern times, they are basically rooted in a sort of mechanical idea of anatomical features which are interlocking with each other, and therefore also relate to theories of thermodynamics, which has to maintain a particular kind of physical equilibrium to make sure that you do not die. In Chinese medicine, on the other hand, the theories are part of the existence of the universe, and as a result of that, your existence is a part of it and functions best when you are an active participant in that universe. As soon as you start doing your own thing, then basically you get lost in that process, and as a result that you will receive damage. Because reality as such is intertwined, your body also is existing by means of all kind of intertwined tissues, and as a result that we see big differences in how the body is being perceived between the Eastern model and the Western model, and we never talk about energy. The methods of learning in Western medicine are starting usually with books. At the moment when you learn from a book, of course the book is valuable and it explains all kinds of things, but then in your learning process you basically learn to accept the knowledge as it is in the book, and then to also perform the protocols that are being produced. And when they think you are ready to execute the protocols, you can do your apprenticeship. So that means you're basically being trained to work like a machine. When you look at Chinese medicine, the primary idea is that you experience reality from a particular kind of perspective, and that perspective has to help you to develop ideas about reality as it is and how you function in that, and you have to resolve some of the basic issues that are part of being you, and as a result of that you actually gradually start applying that to other people so that you can bring them back into the fold of the wholeness of the universe. Concluding from that is that we can see that the practice of Chinese medicine as it is being performed in modern China, in Western cultures, in Africa, in South America and everywhere else in the world where people are practicing currently Chinese medicine or any other form of alternative medicine from another culture, are primarily doing this on the basis of a lie or of a set of lies. These cultures, of course, they are doomed to change anyway, but at the moment when I wanted to study Chinese medicine and Taoism as an extension of that, because that is such an important source of many Chinese medicine wisdoms, I realized that wherever I would go to, I was on the wrong address. When I studied at the Beijing Chinese Medicine University and I worked there, when I was studying in Wuhan at the Chinese Medicine University, when I was studying in Chinese medicine schools in the West, or when I was studying Kung Fu schools in the West or in China, Wudang Mountains, in most cases I was following ideas from Western schools of thoughts, because everybody tried to deduce back everything to that, and that is not what I wanted, and I think you shouldn't want that. And the reason, because we don't want that, is the reason why I started the Daolin program. You could have started the Daolin program if I didn't, if you come across the same stepping stones. So my idea is like that. Are you already studying this kind of fallacy, Chinese medicine? I don't want to insult your feelings or give you a bad feeling about your investments and so on, because this knowledge is, of course, is invaluable, period. There's no doubt about it. But are you willing to accept the fact that it is actually nothing to do with what you want to study, because you want to study Chinese medicine, I guess, because of its Chinese medicine ideas? If you do agree with the fact that maybe it is not fair to study Chinese medicine on the basis of Western assumptions, you can see that in the recognition process of your profession having to be rooted in Western medicine, you can say, okay, maybe you should look out for another program. If you want to study another program, I mean, you're welcome. I'm studying, why shouldn't you?
Oh, look at him, sir. You're an actual Kung Fu master.
Me too!
Yes!
My daughter's...
Oh, you sound also very well. Look at
that. Another one. You also do another one then. Yeah.